All right, so in this video, I'm going to try to analyze some data from City of Chicago website. And we'll take some Chicago crime data and try to do some analysis. So just to get started, I'm on data.cityofchicago.org. If you want to go ahead and download that too, you can. I'm going to open this public safety section. Here, I'm going to find not this one, that's the dashboard. I want the one that's data set. See, here we have a data set, crimes 2001 to present. So I'll go ahead and click on that. That should take us to our tab where we're going to be able to get this data. I'm going to have to export this. So if I go export, and I'm going to do CSV format. I can also do CSV for Excel, I suppose. I'm just going to do regular CSV. That should be fine. There it is, save it. Now this is gonna take some time to download. If I scroll down, we have a data set that has 22 columns and about 7 million rows. One of the problems we're gonna have with this, so for example, for people who like to use Google Sheets, you're never gonna be able to handle this amount of data in Google Sheets. And even in Excel, the regular Excel has, 1 million rows? That's the limit. Now, this is about 7 million rows, so I'm going to have to use some Power BI tools to get this done. So I'm going to use Power Pivot. If I scroll down, you're going to see what columns are available here. We can click Show All to get the rest of the columns. Now, if I scroll down a little bit, we get a little sample of this data set. So we're going to get this ID, case ID, date, the primary type of the crime. Then we have the description. We have a bunch of columns here. You can see we have like the community area where the crime happened, FBI crime code probably, and location and all of this. So a bunch of data. This is going to be a large data set. I'll check how large the file is once it's downloaded. I'm a little worried with the computer that I'm on about this, because on the computer I'll be using to try to analyze this data, I have 8 GB of memory. It's a dual core i7 computer, just to give you a frame of reference. It has a very fast SSD though, that's kind of good, although probably not too important. So I'll just pause the video here until it's download it, and I'll get back to you then. So here's the file. It ended up being 1.7 gigabytes or something like that. So again, this is about 7 million records. I'm not going to be able to directly open this in Excel. So what I'm going to do instead, I'm just going to open Excel, and I'm going to make sure I have Power Pivot activated. So right now, this one doesn't, so I'm going to go under File and Options. In here, I'll go under Add-ins, and I'll switch the Manage to the second option here. Click Go, and here we have Power Pivot. So I'm going to check the box, hit OK. That should load Power Pivot here on top. So now that I have Power Pivot activated, I'm going to go to Manage, and that should load Power Pivot window. All right, so now I need to connect to that data source. So I'm going to go from other sources. And here we need to connect to that CSV file. So if I scroll down, we have the text file option, which what CSV file really is. So next. Now I have to browse and find that file. So here's that Power Pivot folder where I have that file. I'm going to check that. That's a CSV file. See, about 1.6 gigabyte open. Now, since it was a comma CSV file, it's a comma separated. So commas will be our separators. I'm going to make sure that we use the first row as column headers, because as you can see here, we have ID, date, whatever. These are the column names here. I'm going to check this box. And here, because this data is large, I'm going to just remove some of these columns to make sure I only keep the columns I'm actually going to need. I don't really need the case number or the ID of this. So we want to minimize the size of this data, especially when you don't have a supercomputer when you're working with this type of stuff. We're not really working with terabytes of data, but it's still not a small file. So do I need the block? Probably not. We can come back and change this if necessary. For now, this, I'm not even sure what this is, but we can go read the column description. Primary type, we'll keep that. Description, we'll probably keep that. Location, description. I'm basically just getting rid of all these extra columns that at this point I don't want to deal with. And that will hopefully save us a lot of memory. Press finish and hope for the best. Just FYI, I made it 8 times faster than the real time, just so that you don't have to watch that whole thing happening. But that takes quite a bit of time. But as far as I can tell, we have successful import here of our 7 million records. Now I'm going to press close. And we're going to get a small preview of our data set here. Now, the next thing we want to do, we want to make sure we have the data types here picked correctly. Like this column of dates should be dates. So I'm going to click on this, see the data type here. It thinks this is text. So I have to switch this to a date type. So I'm going to switch that to this. This community area thing. That takes a little bit. So I'm going to wait until it's done. All right, so that was not as bad as I thought. This is whole number. That's already good. A year. Whole number. That's also good. This, it says true, false. I don't know if we have a Boolean type. Apparently we do. Let me see if there are any other things here. So seems not. So I'm going to switch this to true, false. Okay, that seems fine. I'm going to say yes. Now that I have all my column types selected here, I'm just going to go back to Excel for a second and just save this file. So I'm going to click on this little Excel icon, Control S. I'm going to call this Power Pivot Test. And Excel workbook, hit save. So I'm going to go back to manage. We're back to this. Now I should be able to make a pivot table out of this data directly. So if I go and click on this pivot table, see, it's going to ask us, where do we want this pivot table? New worksheet, or I can put it in here in my existing one. Doesn't matter. So now we should be able to work with this pretty much like we work with a regular pivot table. We're not going to be able to see the data though. So I'm going to open this. So let's start easy. So let's just get the number of crimes by year. First thing to see about this data is basically every line is one occurrence of a crime. So if we just count number of rows, that should give us number of crimes. And then we can break it down by type and things like this. So let's just count things. So one of the things we have to do when we're counting this is to make sure we count a column that has values. Now, it's very hard to tell if there are values always in one of these columns. So I'm going to just test a couple of columns here to count. I'm going to count this column of years. And then I'll also count maybe the community area or something. Let's see if we get the same number when we count both of those. So first, I'll take the year, move it to values. Now that started summing that, I want that to be counting it. So I'm going to right click here, go under value field settings and change this to count. So that gives us 7,039,802. So if that actually ends up being the same number as we had in that download page, then this should be correct already. So let's go check. There it is. So we have the actual number. 7,039,802. Is that the same number? Yeah. So excellent. So this should work, so I don't have to look for another one. For my value field, that would be the count of this. I'm going to just reformat this, right-click number format, make it a number format with a comma, thousand separator. We're not going to need decimal points, so I'm going to switch that to zero, press OK. So now if I want to break this down by year, I can take the year column, move it to rows, and we should have our crimes by year. So you can see that total crime count in 2001 was 485,000. And it seems like it's decreasing over years. So you could even say it's half of what it used to be before. Now, I'm not sure if this 2019 data is complete. We'll probably have to go check, but 2018 should definitely be complete. Data last updated January 1st, 2020. I guess that means we have all of it. So I'm still not sure though, so I'm gonna have to look at a couple of things here. If I try to break this down by date, now before I do that, I'm gonna save this file because it could crash on me potentially. So I'm gonna take the date and move it to rows. So that actually handled it a lot better than I thought it would. I don't need the quarter. I don't need the year because we already have the year. We do have the month now. I'm gonna take the year and move it to columns at this point so we can see what's going on. So we do have pretty much all the months, even if we consider that December is not complete, at least the first 11 months are accurate. Now, first of all, let me show you what happened when I dragged that date column over here in the rows. So I'm going to go back to manage under Power Pivot. And what it did, it basically created this calculated columns for us. See, we have this year column, date, which is the quarter. We have the month, which it does the index of the month, and it did the month. Now, if you go here and you cannot really see all of these columns, which may happen sometimes, you may have to refresh this whole thing. And the way you would refresh this, you would go under Data tab and click Refresh. And I'm not going to do it right now because it's going to take a long time to reload that 7 million rows all over again. So we don't want to do that. I'm going to go to Power Pivot and click Manage. So in some older versions of Power Pivot, these columns will not be created automatically like this for you. So you may have to manually create this extra calculated columns. And what you would do in those cases, you would just come here when it says add a column, double click here, give this column a name. I'm going to call it month, maybe just month because there's no column like that. Hit enter. And then you click in the cell right below, you do equals and you use the function month, open parentheses. See, it's right here in my formula bar. Now I have to get this column date, that's what the column is called. So I'm going to open the square bracket and start typing date. There's that column like this, close parentheses, hit enter. And that would get you extra calculated column here. That would get you the month number that you could use, which is basically like this one that was automatically created for us. So you can see if I click on this formula, like this is exactly the same as I click on this one. See, it's the same formula, the same way you could do like the year. So if I click on this, well, they didn't use the year function, but instead of doing this, you could also just do equals year. And you would do this as an extra column, but I don't really need this column, so I'm just going to show you here. So again, the same thing. You would just use that date column inside of the function year instead of the function month. And that should give you a calculated year column. Now, I don't really need any of this, so I'm going to just remove this column out of here. Right-click, delete column. Are you sure? Yes. Save this. And I'm going to click on this Excel icon to get back to this pivot table. All right, so now this data in this shape, when we have our years in columns and months in rows, we should be able to create a nice chart out of this. So I'm going to go to Insert and choose a line chart. So a 2D line, something like this. Let me just expand this a little bit. So now each line is representing one of the years. And then we have this chart month to month from January through December. Now we can definitely see there is a pattern. So we have increasing crime in July, August, June, kind of that part, September, like over here in this area. And wintertime, decreasing crime. So see, like December. And it seems like, as a rule of thumb, February seems to be the lowest out of all of those. So that's a nice chart, shows the pattern. I have to say, I'm impressed how we're able to handle this amount of data with Power Pivot on this type of computer setup. Just out of curiosity, I want to open the task manager to see what's going on. All right, so here's the task manager. If I look at memory, we're using 3.5 gigabytes of memory right now to control this data. So that's enough on this video. I'm gonna finish it on this. In the next video, we'll start making some other charts and get some nice visuals of this data to see what we have. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe. I'll see you in the next video.